Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We will consider the Budget Bill at Stage 2 today, but before we turn to formal Stage 2 proceedings, we will take evidence on the Scottish Government's response to a report on the Scottish Budget 2023-24. We are joined today by John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery. Mr Swinney is accompanied by Scottish Government officials, Alison Cumming, Director of Budget and Public Spending, and Lorraine King, Deputy Director, Tax and Revenues Directorate. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Members received copies of the Scottish Government response on Friday. And before we move to questions from the committee, I invite Mr Swinney to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'd like to thank the committee for its budget scrutiny report, which I have carefully considered and responded to last week. As I've highlighted to the committee, this budget has been developed amidst very challenging economic and fiscal circumstances. It is a budget which focuses substantial resources to support families, businesses and public services in accordance with our three overarching strategic objectives in the budget. The committee will be aware that I'm not proposing any amendments to the budget bill today, and I'm very happy to respond to questions from the committee on its report.
Thank you very much for that brief opening statement. As is traditional, of course, I will start with a few questions and then we will open out the session to colleagues around the table. So the first question I'm going to ask relates to a question I actually posed in the chamber in which you responded to on Thursday, which was regarding the gap, the kind of the estimated overspend that we have. Now, when you gave evidence about 3 weeks ago, I believe it was between £200 and £500 million. And work has obviously progressed to reduce that to around £100 million. So I've really got two questions on that. One, how have you managed to reduce that to the £100 million? And what steps are being taken to try and eliminate it altogether between now and the end of the financial year?
A number of steps have been taken, Convener. There's obviously a constant revision of the estimates that are submitted to the central finance team in relation to the expectations about budget performance. And obviously, as time goes on, risks are addressed in those numbers and they are revised. So there'll be revisions down in the estimates of overspend that come in simply because the passage of time is giving us more certainty about the likelihood of the delivery of the budgets in line with our expectations. So that's the first factor. The second is that we are applying very rigorous scrutiny to any new spending that is undertaken. So there's a very detailed scrutiny process which, if necessary, ultimately comes to me for decisions as to whether or not programmes are approved. And judgments are made there, so obviously there are certain programmes are being delayed as a consequence, or items of expenditure being delayed as a consequence of all of that. And then thirdly, we are then looking also at the performance of individual items of budget volatility, whether that's about tax revenues, social security expenditure, as we assess what is the likely outturn to be the case. But we still have that budget gap that I highlighted to you in the chamber last week, Convener. In terms of further steps that we are taking to address this issue, obviously all of what I've said continues to be applied on a very rigorous basis to get to the point where we are in a position to balance the budget. So I assure the committee, as I've done in writing, of the very assiduous efforts that are going on to do that, and every effort will be made to ensure that is the case before the end of the financial year.
So, for example, in some demand-led areas, there may be less demand than one anticipated, and it could be that taxes are a wee bit higher also than was perhaps originally anticipated. What kind of projects have been delayed, though? What are we kind of talking about here?
There'll tend to be, at this stage in the financial year, there'll tend to be more minor aspects of public spending programmes that will be coming forward. We will look to take those forward as early as we possibly can do, and it may be that they have to run into the next financial year to be commenced, but it will be a variety of different programmes across government.
Are these programmes, in some cases, which are, I mean, are you moving the kind of accounting, shall we say, into next year, but the projects are still continuing, or are you actually having delays to existing projects?
We can't move the accounting.
I'm just wondering if there was any
that.
Kind
that's,
of
that's, I know just, that's just not possible.
I just wanted to clarify that.
So the program has to be delayed.
Yes.
Because if the spending, if the expense, the crucial point here is if the activity and expenditure is incurred in this financial year, it has to be accounted for in this financial year. It's the way the accounting rules operate.
No, I was really keen to get that on the record, actually, because I know we talk about how the we always have to balance the budget, and I think sometimes people think, oh, we can just kick it into next year or whatever it happens to be.
If a project is delayed and is expected then to be delivered next year,
then will be next year.
That adds financial strain to next year. So,
of course,
But these are the day-to-day judgments that have to be applied to make sure that we can bring the budget.
Colleagues may or may not wish to pursue that further. Now, on taxation, there's been a number of issues we obviously raised as a committee in terms of taxation. So, for example, obviously we looked at when the Scottish Government planned to publish a discussion paper on tax and spending choices, and in the response is that the rationale for the document that's changed the UK government's mini budget is gradually unwound. So what is the rationale? Is it because of volatility at the moment, or are there other factors which are given consideration to that? Well, I'll let you respond to that one first.
I think the original genesis of a tax discussion paper was essentially in response to what was a very dramatic change to the comparative landscape on taxation as a result of the mini budget in September. So, when I came to the committee, I indicated that I thought further dialogue was required given the nature of the significance of the divergence that had been announced. Well, as we all know, that didn't last very long. So the necessity of it, of that particular imperative, moved on. So there's obviously, the immediate urgency and necessity of that discussion was not apparent. What I've charted in my response to the committee is that to support our own decision making about the decisions we took in the budget in December, we undertook an extensive amount of stakeholder discussion and dialogue. I chaired a number of panel discussions of a broad range of stakeholders to hear views. The Minister for Public Finance did likewise, and obviously there's a whole variety of other discussions that take place around about that. So we had an extensive amount of consultation activity, but what we didn't necessarily have was a consultation paper and a wide open consultation in the fashion that colleagues would with which colleagues would be familiar. Now, I think there is a space and a place for us to embark on some longer-term discussions about taxation. So I would remain open to some of those questions being looked at in the future. But the immediate urgency was driven by what was quite dramatic changes to the tax landscape, which, as we all know, didn't last long.
Okay, well, thank you for that. Now, obviously, an area of taxation where there's concern is council tax, and there's a working group which includes representative causes being set up to consider proposals for meaningful changes to be introduced in the short term, such as increasing rates of council tax on second and empty homes, and the group will also consider approaches to long-term reform. When is this working group likely to report?
What I'm probably best to say is that the working group has started its activity. It's difficult for me to predict exactly when it will report, but we are anxious to make sure that early progress is made so that we can consider and take forward a wider discussion with with stakeholders about any implications, given the fact that this is material for the decision-making of local authorities in relation to council tax. So I'd want that process to be as concluded as swiftly as possible, but it's difficult for me to give a definitive timescale for that. But I do recognise the urgency of that work to be taken forward, and it is underway.
Now, staying with council tax, the Scottish Government currently provides, council tax relief, if you like. So basically, 450,000 households receive council tax reduction, and on average, recipients save over £750 a year. So that's, by my calculations, a Scottish Government investment of £337.5 million, roughly, give or take £1 or £2 million, I imagine, in terms of that. Now, if council tax increases substantially this year, do you envisage a significant increase in the Scottish Government's input into that?
The council tax reduction scheme is essentially a reflection of changes that are undertaken within council tax, so that there is the potential for these issues to be a factor with which we have to wrestle. But that's part and parcel of the volatility in income that government has to manage on an annual basis.
Okay. One other thing, which I think is very important in terms of future Scottish Government policy and thinking, is the issue of behavioural change. Now, as you know, the Scottish Fiscal Commission spoke to us and said on paper higher additional rate of tax would raise £30 million, but in reality they believe it would only raise £3 million because of behavioural change, although they emphasise more people not working as hard as opposed to, for example, moving south of the border in terms of their taxes, if they've got more than one address. However, in your response, you said that the Scottish Government actually looked at this, and you said the study found no evidence of significant behaviour change, including cross-border migration, as a result of the move to a more progressive tax system. So I'm just wondering how that sits with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, because they're saying 90% will be lost by a simple penny, which seemed to me a very dramatic loss for a small increase, and yet the Scottish Government appears to be saying, well, in actual fact, we don't really see this. But in previous meetings with the committee, you've suggested that the Scottish Government is very aware of behaviour change. So I'm just wondering where we are on this whole subject, which clearly needs greater exploration.
I think how I would describe it, Convener, is that I acknowledge the risk of behaviour change. And so I'm not sitting here in denial that it's not a factor. I think what our response is designed to say that on the basis of what information we have not seen evidence of people relocating for tax purposes, is probably the best way that I would describe it. That doesn't mean to say that whilst people are not relocating for tax purposes, there may not be a certain amount of behavioural change in the way that income is accounted for or arrangements are put in place, because I think those are two very different practices within tax planning. So I think we are also, Convener, really quite early in the era of tax divergence between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. There isn't a lot of years of experience of this that have been the case. So we've got to be attentive to the detail. I think we've got to be open about exploring these questions. And I think in the policy-making space, we've got to be conscious of the risks of behavioural change and factor those implications into our consideration of what are the right, if any, tax changes to make.
Okay. Now, obviously the National Care Service is an issue that's had quite a lot of focus in recent days and weeks, actually. And this committee will be looking to scrutinise an updated financial memorandum, perhaps towards the beginning of next month, if not the end of this month. But obviously, concerns have been raised, including by members of this committee in chamber and beyond, about how much of next year's budget will be allocated to National Care Service. So I'm just wondering if you can enlighten us a wee bit on that.
I think I don't think I've got much more to add to what I said to the committee when I was here last time round, that we have made provision in the budget for a range of measures in relation to the National Care Service, not least of which is the increase in social care payment rates, which is, you know, accounts for a substantial part of the journey we're trying to undertake on the National Care Service to increase the remuneration for social care staff so that that career is a more attractive proposition. Obviously, specific details about the delivery of the National Care Service will be linked directly to the financial memorandum that comes to the committee in due course, and that will set out some of the further detailed planning that's undertaken in this respect.
Okay, I just wonder if you'll accept that there's an element of frustration in the committee that we won't get the financial memorandum until after stage three is passed, and obviously members are quite keen to know how much of a commitment there is specifically to the NCS. So we know there's a note, obviously, we know the size of the overall budget, and there's more than £1 billion extra going into health and social care this year. But it's that aspect of it, I think, that there's a focus on. And we heard in the chamber last week wildly differing figures of how much it will cost over the next 5 years, partly because we don't have a real grip on the financial memorandum and exactly what it's likely to say. So just wondering, any help in terms of parameters would be useful, you know, minimums and maximums, for example.
You know, that's really my point, my answer, convener, that, you know, the overwhelming majority of the expenditure that's envisaged in relation to the National Care Service in the next financial year will be in relation to the improvements to social care staff pay, and the other, you know, if I call them the kind of governance costs and the preparations for the service, are very much the minority. Now, the financial memorandum will, as that is redeveloped, and you're asking me to commit detail in advance of it being finalised within government, which I'm not in a position to do today. But I think what I've said to you about the balance of expenditure between the larger amounts on the social care remuneration and the smaller amounts on governance, I hope helps the committee in finding comfort in this issue.
Sorry, Deputy First Minister, I'm not really trying to get the specifics for the reasons that you've outlined, but what I'm trying to do is get parameters. You know, what's the minimum is likely to cost, and what's the maximum it's likely to cost, which surely government must be aware of at this stage in the budget process.
I think the maximum cost in terms of the next financial year is likely to be a figure no higher than about perhaps £50 million.
But
the financial memorandum will give greater confidence around that point.
Okay, but that's certainly helpful, and it's a lower figure than I think certainly that I've heard, and I'm sure others have heard, and colleagues may wish to pursue that further. Now, I want to just talk about the capital and fiscal framework. Obviously, it's been a very disappointing year in terms of capital allocation from UK government has been reduced by £185 million. Obviously, with inflation, that figure is actually higher. But when we were basically asking about questions with regard to capital and fiscal framework, the response was that the Scottish Government has disproportionately constrained borrowing and reserve powers. Now, since 2016, inflation has been 39% And basically, the Scottish Government is still working with the same kind of figures that it had all those years ago. So I'm just wondering if you've got any indications from the UK Government as to when they would be willing to review the kind of borrowing figures, for example, when it is, you know, 50%. Inflation is 50% higher than it was in 2016, 60%, 70%. What kind of ongoing discussions do we have? Because this is clearly having an impact on the Scottish Government's ability to manage its finances.
But these issues are tied up essentially with two things, convener. Any annual or periodic revisions of capital frameworks that are put in place by the United Kingdom Government. So, you know, part of what has been my challenge in this financial year has been that we have had no restating of the budget in the light of the significantly different inflation climate that we face now compared to when the budget was set. So I rehearsed these issues with Liz Smith when I was at committee the last time. The budget was set essentially in a context in late 2021, where inflation was benign, and then we faced raging inflation for the whole of this financial year, which is part of why I'm wrestling with the issue that you raised with me in your first question, convener, about the financial pressures in this financial year. And there has been no restatement of the budget to take account of that factor. So that's where some of the solution could lie, in a restatement of the position. And then secondly, the other area is in the review of the fiscal framework in a more of a procedural space where borrowing limits could be revisited and recast. And obviously we've got discussions to be had with the United Kingdom Government on the fiscal framework, and those are at a very early stage.
I mean, the fiscal framework's an issue, and I'm sure other colleagues will ask about that, which is why I didn't. But I think it's an issue that, you know, the committee is becoming increasingly concerned about, because we don't seem to have moved forward really in the last year, I think, on that. And I know there's been a lot of chaos with four chancellors and three prime ministers.
But I think, to be honest, yeah, convener, I frankly would question the value of any conversation with most of the people I've been dealing with over the last the interim period in which I've been here, because of the degree of churn, if we could perhaps put it as delicately as that.
Yes, absolutely. Indeed.
But things are hopefully, although I understand there's a UK government reshuffle going on just now, so who knows, we might have more churn before the day is out. But
indeed. Now, capital projects, and there's obviously some of these have had to be deprioritised, and I'm quite keen to get some information on what some of those are. I think there's one in my constituency I'm aware of for a start, but major rail projects seem to be one of the areas where there's been a deprioritisation. But yet, you know, the Scottish Government has met its commitment to expand its green investment portfolio, exceeding the target by around 15%, up to £3.4 billion. So there's also some good news in there, is there not?
Well, I think what we've got to be conscious of is that the effect of inflation will affect capital projects in different ways. So, for example, any capital project that requires a raw material inputs is going to face significant challenges because of all of the implications for supply chains and costs that have happened as a consequence of, you know, the aftermath of COVID and then the disruption of the conflict in Ukraine. Some other aspects of capital expenditure, as you highlight, convener, some of the moves to net zero, some of the investments that are made in research activity, for example, these are less susceptible to some of the erosion of value as a consequence of inflation. The point I would make to the committee is that the approach that, you know, we are essentially having to ask portfolios, we're making portfolio allocations, and we're having to ask portfolios to undertake prudential judgments about the timing and the progress of projects based on what value they can achieve as a consequence. So there will be projects that are finding where the cost estimates are increasing very significantly, and therefore it's not prudential to proceed with those just now, because in a few months' time there may be an ability to secure a more competitive price for those projects by the deployment of that capital expenditure at that time, because the inflationary pressure has receded to an extent. So it's what I would say is the best way to perhaps characterise this is that we're asking portfolios to align their commitments with due regard to the inflationary climate, rather than reprioritising. Maybe we're just using different words, convener, in that respect. But it's to try to get. One of the points I made in my budget statement, there were four sort of factors that I identified in my budget statement before I got on to the detail. And one of them, I said the significant increases in input prices and energy costs mean that our capital budget will be unable to deliver as much as would have been judged possible just a few months ago. The government will keep these factors under constant review as we take forward the capital programme. Now, that is essentially what I've just said we are doing, that we're conscious of the corrosive effect of inflation, and we're trying to make the most appropriate and prudential judgments about when we should deploy particular projects with regard to the inflationary pressures.
I mean, I think the difficulty, though, is that even if inflation declines dramatically, which everyone anticipates it will this year, the prices are still fixed at a high level. Yeah. And because the capital allocation has shrunk, you're still going to have to try and squeeze a quarter into a pint pot. But I was intrigued to find that the green investment portfolio has already attracted £300 million in private investment, with £875 million currently under offer and active discussion. So there is a significant private resource to come in to help boost and deliver these projects, is there not?
Totally. And what government has got to make sure we are effective in doing is giving the policy certainty and direction to the private sector to enable investment to be undertaken. So if I give the example of the decarbonisation of electricity, the government gave policy certainty that it wanted to decarbonise electricity generation within Scotland. And that policy certainty has been given for the entire duration of this administration, for nearly 16 years. And as a consequence, we have largely decarbonised our electricity generation means in Scotland. And that's not been done by government investment, it's been done by government policy certainty. But it's been delivered by private investment, and that's the type of climate we've got to operate now. As for private investment, I am, was at the First Minister and I took part the other week there in the it used to be called the Financial Services Advisory Board, but I can't remember what it's currently called, and it was very, and that brings together a variety of different interested parties from the financial services community. And the Lord Mayor of the City of London was at that particular discussion. And that whole discussion was predicated on the significant availability of private sector investment to support a number of opportunities, but especially the journey to net zero, and the government's policy direction, we believe, will help in that respect.
I think what's helped the government's policy direction is that stability over such a long period of time, whereas south of the border there's been incredible turmoil in terms of energy policy, going in all sorts of different directions, reversing, up, down, roundabout. There's been very little consistency for long-term financial planning, whether you're talking about wind, solar, nuclear, whatever it happens to be. So I take that on board. Just one last question for me, actually, and it's regarding growing the tax base and productivity, because obviously that's a real key area for us. And you've responded to our questions on that by saying that economic modelling estimates delivery of key components of the National Strategy for Economic Transformation could increase the size of the Scottish economy at least £8 billion, which is almost 5%, other than it would have been by 2032. So you've gone on to talk about, for example, a network of hubs to support high growth tech businesses, technology sector export plan, hydrogen innovation scheme, low carbon manufacturing challenge fund. But I'm just wondering what other components there are which will deliver that $8 billion extra. And secondly, in terms of ScotWind leasing, you basically talked about perhaps £28 billion of potential Scottish economic activity. So I'm wondering over what kind of time period that's going to be delivered.
Well, the National Strategy for Economic Transformation is set over a 10-year period, convener. So my expectations would be that it would be within that period. And I think in terms of the elements that are important, I would highlight perhaps three distinctive elements. Firstly is the development of entrepreneurship, the entrepreneurial people and culture element of the national strategy, which I think is absolutely vital in terms, and it relates to some of the points that you've put on the record, convener, about the tech scalers. I think we've seen very formidable improvements in performance as a consequence of some of these concepts already, and the government is investing to roll these out around the country. The second element is about the necessity to have productive regions and regional economies in Scotland. I was recently viewing, as an example of this, an investment that the government has brokered along with Hans Anz Enterprise, the Western Isles Council, Stornoway Trust and Stornoway Port Authority in the construction of a deep water port in Stornoway, which is making formidable progress on the ground. It's really, you know, making remarkable physical progress. But what that will open up is the opportunity for very significant new marine-based activity in the Western Isles. First tranche of that will be cruise ships will be able to berth in Stornoway Harbour, which they currently cannot, large ones cannot currently do. That will, you know, I was listening to some of the preparatory work that's been undertaken to develop more economic opportunities in the Western Isles to accommodate the interest and enthusiasm of visitors coming on these cruise ships into the area. We've already seen some of that success demonstrated very effectively in Orkney, for example, where cruise ships can get right into Hatton Pier. That first tranche will significantly boost the economy of the Western Isles. That's before we get anywhere near hydrogen and the ability to develop green hydrogen from the renewable energy footprint, which will come from the ScotWind process. So that's just one example of one regional policy intervention the government is involved in supporting, and we're involved in supporting many others around about the country. And then the third element is essentially around the development of the necessary skills and capacity to ensure that we can make the most of the changes in the economy that are coming our way. I'm very confident that as a consequence of the much better dialogue we now have involving relationships between our college sector and business, for example, that our colleges are very attentive to finding the skills requirements that companies require to support the transition, particularly to net zero, and to be able to invest accordingly. So those three issues of entrepreneurship, regional policy and skills lie at the heart of addressing the productivity challenge that you put to me, convener.
Yeah, thanks very much. Yeah, a very positive and productive meeting with my own local Ayrshire College just last Friday. Okay, I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues around the table. First will be Daniel, to be followed by Douglas.
Thank you very much, convener. And I just really want to just initially just follow up on the answer you gave around the cost for the National Care Service in the coming financial year, which you stated was approximately £50 million, excluding costs of increasing pay for social care workers. And the financial memorandum that we currently have sets up costs of the National Care Service over a 5-year period. And the costs for the coming financial year, 23-24, were ranged between £63 and £95 million. And if you look at those costs, that's all essentially from the establishment phase of the National Care Service in terms of central administration. And indeed, the actual running costs in that, within that 5-year period really don't start kicking in until 5 years. So if the plan was to spend between 60 and, you know, 90 odd million pounds, and you're now spending £50 million in the coming year, does that imply a delay to the full implementation of the National Care Service? If so, what is being held back? What are you rephasing in that plan?
I don't think it says that. I think it just says that's the best estimate that we have. Obviously, a financial memorandum looks many years hence. Operational decisions are taken about what is the expected expenditure in any particular programme, and those numbers will be, they will be reviewed on a constant basis. But as I've tried to explain to the committee before, the government is concentrating on the preparations here in two respects: getting the initial organisational arrangements in place, but then also in boosting the salaries of social care workers, which is what we've allocated the substantial amount of money within the budget to enable that to be the case.
I understand that financial memorandum is a broadly stated thing. I mean, we're all used to financial memorandums not necessarily bearing out to be 100% accurate, if I can put it like that. But it strikes me that this was a memorandum that was only published 6 months ago or thereabouts. It was implying costs not just for this coming financial year, but in the current financial year, of not insignificant amounts. But you're now saying that the amount that will be spent is almost 50% of what the upper range was, and certainly lower than the lower range. It just strikes me that some...
I think we're really stretching this point, are we not? The sum of money that I've put on the record is in very close proximity to the lower end of the financial memorandum. So, I think we're at risk of making a mountain out of a molehill here.
Well, forgive me, Deputy First Minister, but if in my previous life I spent a long time looking at both financial plans and project plans, and if a project and or indeed a programme plan was at 20% variance within 6 months of the plan being published, which is essentially what we're saying, 15-20%, something would have changed somewhere. Now, you may say that won't have a very significant impact in a programme which is scheduled to cost well over £1 billion, and I'll accept that. But what I don't accept is that there's been essentially no change and there's nothing to see. I'm really just trying to understand what has altered in the government's planning, thinking and assumptions in this plan to actually say that the projected cost of the financial year are going to undershoot what the plan was in a plan that was only published 6 months ago. It's not a major point, but I think something must have changed.
Well, all I'm trying to say is that I don't think there's an awful lot of difference between the two numbers that we're talking about. It's the only point I'm making.
Well, again, we're talking about a financial year which, by your own estimation, is going to be incredibly tight. And therefore, understanding really how the government is controlling costs, I think, is important. And this may be relatively small money in the grand scheme of things, but these things do add up. But if you're not wanting to go into it any further, I'm happy to move on. I mean, what I am interested in substantially is really understanding about the risks and the parameters of this budget. There's a great deal of unpredictability. And thinking about, again, wearing one of my previous hats, I always look at a budget thinking about fixed and variable costs, costs which are under control and costs which are beyond your control. And I'd just really like to ask some questions about that. Firstly, about payroll, but then also things like energy costs and material costs. So very approximately, of the £45 billion of resource spending within the budget, around half is on payroll costs, about £21 billion. I'd just like to ask, do you anticipate that going up or down in the coming year? And also, there isn't a public sector payroll, public sector pay policy accompanying this. I'd just like to understand whether the £10.50 pay floor, which was introduced in the last pay policy, whether that will continue, or indeed whether that pay floor will increase in the coming financial year.
It's quite a lot in there, Convener,
yeah,
so
apologies.
Let me try and work my way through all of it as best I can. In relation to payroll costs, I would imagine those costs will increase during the year, because I don't think the degree to which public sector headcount will fall over the course of the year will be outweighed by the increase in salary costs that will take place.
Yeah.
That's my. That's, you know, I'm not going to shortly produce an Excel spreadsheet that gives the modelling behind that, but that would be my best assessment of what is the position likely to be in relation to Mr. Johnson's question. On the second point, in relation to the role of pay policy, I haven't stipulated a pay policy for what I think is a pragmatic reason, that we stipulated a pay policy last year and it became pretty meaningless pretty quickly. So we are essentially trying to do some further work to establish what might be the parameters of pay policy in terms of the expression of that pay policy. But the parameters of pay policy are that organisations committing to pay deals have to be able to afford them within the budgets that are being set. So I wouldn't want the committee to think that there aren't parameters on pay. There certainly are parameters on pay. Affordability is the big parameter on pay policy as we navigate our way through a volatile climate. Now, thirdly, the other big variable is energy costs, and they will be influenced by some of the decisions that the United Kingdom government takes on the management of energy costs. But essentially, we are saying to public bodies and organisations they have to live with those challenges. And then I think the last area that Mr. Johnson asked me about was about the £10.50 pay floor, and that, my view would be that would rise to £10.90 as a consequence of the steps we take.
That's helpful. I'll come to energy policy in a moment, but just to round out the conversation around payroll, I mean, obviously there's a number of other costs that can be attributed, and again, it's very important to manage those things, i.e. vacancy rates can have a cost. They can lead to a supplementation through agency staff. There's also the use of sort of third party, both contractors or outsized resource. I just wonder if there are broad parameters that you have set for the use of agency staff and third parties, and also what is the level of vacancy across the public sector, or certainly those bits that are directly under your control, and how are you managing those things?
Okay. There will be variables in costs. One of the factors that public bodies expected at one stage to have to deal with was increased national insurance contribution costs. Now, that has not been the case. That's been reversed. So, for example, for local government, and I know local government finance has been a very active issue, that's a saving for local government of about £70 million. So that frees up expenditure within local authorities. In relation to vacancy, on the fundamental point that Mr. Johnson raises, I think I would best summarise it by saying that any employment arrangement that is not direct employment is more expensive than direct employment. Yeah. So it's generally undesirable. So one of the points that we are trying to address, for example, in the discussions with the trade unions in the health service, is to get to a position where we address some of the underlying issues that might encourage or tempt members of staff to operate in an agency rather than an employment status. So we try to reshape that balance so that more people are on employee payroll as opposed to on agency payroll. Because if you're running a hospital ward, you've got to have the requisite number of people. And if you don't have them on payroll, direct payroll, you've got to go to agency. And that will come at more cost. So the more we can undermine or reduce non-employee payroll costs, the better. So that's the strategic guidance that is being issued in that respect.
So can I just confirm, so is that a formal policy? I mean, have you issued that instruction to the civil service that around minimising that? And likewise, are there formal recruitment freezes in place currently? Or are there short-term steps that you've taken?
We're not. I don't think I could say that we've issued a formal directive to all public bodies on that point. But these are well-established practices of what we would expect leaders of organisations to undertake, because of the very fundamental point I made to Mr. Johnson, that non-employee payroll costs are more expensive than employee payroll costs. So in terms of the prudential management of public finances, we would expect that to be undertaken by individuals. Now, in relation to the Scottish Government, we are, we have headcount controls in place. We are working to reduce overall staff numbers. Obviously, I should express that. To contain staff numbers, obviously we've got increases in staff numbers because a few years ago we weren't responsible for any aspects of social security. We now are, so we've now got more employees as a consequence. But we are trying to reduce those costs, and we have formal headcount controls in place that require appropriate sign-off within the organisation.
Thank you. And at the risk of continuing my sort of technical line of questioning, I mean, I think everyone is familiar with the issues around rising energy costs. All organisations are facing them, and the public sector in Scotland will be no different. I would just be interested in what is the total sort of energy bill, and actually particularly the exposure to gas, and what are the implications of the ending of the UK government's arrangements directly on the public sector in April? And do you have a broad sense of the risk exposure the public sector has to gas volatility over the coming budget year?
I think I'd probably be best to say that I should write to the committee with some detail on this, because I don't have that at the front of my mind today in relation to a specific comprehensive cost of that. I would counsel that this is not just about gas prices.
No.
It's the gas price is then a driver of
yes.
electricity price, which is of great concern. Obviously, the reason why I'm also, I think I better just get precise information, is that there will be extensive collective public procurement of electricity and gas supplies, which may have been bought at a time which has provided us with more or less protection. But I think I better write to the committee about that detail.
Yeah, and apologies for being very technical, but I think these are significant organisational yeah. budgetary but exposures, and I think they could be overlooked, and therefore I think it's of sort of interest in terms of this committee's.
I think the point which I'm happy to agree with Mr. Johnson about is that there's a whole host
yeah.
of inherent pressures in the budget. So to go back to the very starting point of Mr. Johnson's questions in this section was about a point about the degree of risk that is inherent in the budget. And I would have to accept there is a significant amount of risk because we're living in very, very volatile times in terms of inflation, the implications of inflation on employment costs, energy prices, and the cost of procurement of materials, which is getting better now. Earlier on this year, it was at its most acute and sharp and difficult. It is getting better now as some of the supply chains and alternatives to the Ukraine situation, the disruption around about Ukraine, begin to settle down. But we still face very significant risks. And, of course, that could all change very dramatically as well.
Thank you. And just one final question. Again, very happy for you to get back. I don't necessarily expect you to have this to hand. But I mean, one of your key points in your introduction was the number of demand-led budget lines and that being a source of uncertainty. Do you have a global figure for the proportion of the Scottish Government budget which is demand-led?
Not off the top of my head, but I could provide that to the committee. But it will it will include, obviously a much larger proportion than it ever used to in the past because of the presence and prevalence of social security expenditure. But it will include also aspects of concessionary travel, education maintenance allowances, agricultural payments, rail subsidy schemes, so there will be quite a number, but we can provide the committee with our best estimate of that.
Thank you, that would be helpful. And I think the committee having sort of an understanding of the risk profile and uncertainty, I think, would be very helpful. So thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Douglas, and followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. Deputy First Minister, I want to ask a bit more about public sector reform. Obviously, the committee were disappointed that we didn't have any of the initial outcomes. The Auditor General said that public service reform is now urgent. So can you maybe talk us through what is happening and when the committee will actually see some of the thinking that the government's got on that? And just a sort of timetable for that as well, Deputy First Minister.
I'm conscious of the committee's interest in this topic, and I think I have a feeling that we may have been, the government and the committee may have been talking at cross purposes about this, because I certainly don't want the committee to have the view that we are waiting for some moment of public sector reform to come along. Public sector reform is underway on an ongoing basis. There's a number of live examples of that I would cite as the Best Start Bright Futures programme, which is in relation to the child poverty alleviation work, eradication work, which involves a significant amount of public sector reform. The work on keeping the promise is about public sector reform, because that relates to how we support some of our most children that face the greatest of challenges. There is work underway on the on education reform around the Scottish Qualifications Authority and Education Scotland. There is the wider reform work that's been undertaken through the introduction of early learning and childcare, which of course was completed last year. So I think the way, and I understand the committee feels that, I suppose, there was a big report waiting to be published. I think why I would essentially characterise it as the government is committed to the Christie Commission principles. We have been taking them forward on an ongoing basis since the Christie Commission reported. These are some of the most recent examples of what we have undertaken, and the COVID recovery strategy, which involves a significant reshaping of the public sector into person-centred, the delivery of public into person-centred public services, is perhaps the another of the most recent distillations of what the government has undertaken.
I guess taking that a stage further, maybe what I was expecting, when we think of things like the local governance review about public bodies working closer together, maybe co-locating a lot of areas to try and get you know, the asset base down, maybe even reducing the headcount would reduce, as we've discussed earlier with Daniel Johnson. So I guess it's sort of that areas that we were expecting some more information. And is that work ongoing then? Or?
Yes. And so I appreciate Mr. Lumsden's question. So yes, that, you know, so we are directly working with public body leaders on estate rationalisation, on bodies working together. You know, we're trying to encourage frequently steps to reduce estate utilisation by co-location. Obviously, we're in a context now where the world is quite different because not everybody's working in an office as they generally used to be. So there are opportunities to reshape estate provision, and they should be taken, make no mistake about that, because of the necessity of reducing overall cost and making impact. So that whole range of activity and dialogue with public body chief executives is being taken forward, and there's groupings of public body leaders that work together on some of these projects, and we've encouraged them and motivated them to take as significant action as they can.
So what should we expect as a committee to see coming forward? You know, should there be a blueprint and how we all work together? Because, you know, we talk about digitisation as well. You know, we do have to be more efficient going forward. We have to, you know, as we've seen, you know, headcount reduction will probably have to come through to try and, you know, maintain the public sector payable at the level it is or increasing slightly. So I guess it's we as a committee, we'd like to see where we're going and what the impact that will be to our public services.
I think it depends what we mean by a blueprint. If it's a sort of a list of you know, office buildings that will be rationalised, and all, I think that's unlikely, because I don't think that's the way that a programme like that should be predicated. What we should be starting it off, the perspective we should be starting it off from, is how do we reduce the costs, improve the efficiency, rationalise the estate, and then put the challenge to public bodies to make sure that happens. Now, obviously, some of these things will have to happen because of the financial constraints that are applied because of the budget, and that will apply right across the public sector. So I think the government would be able, and I hope in the response to the committee's report and the detail that we've gone into in that respect, gives the committee more clarity about the direction of travel. What it doesn't do is say these are the list of operational changes that will take place, but we can obviously report on them as they take their course.
And it doesn't give a timetable as well. I think it's what we were looking for as a committee.
Okay. Well, we certainly, I'm very happy to commit to keep the committee informed about developments in that respect, which I think would perhaps address some of the issues.
Because would you agree that all these things are vital going forward to try and maintain the public sector pay bill at a level of approximately where it is now?
It absolutely is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we look forward to seeing that. You mentioned flexibilities, and I think when the last time you were here, Deputy First Minister, about moving capital to resource spend. Has there been any update on whether you've been given that flexibility from the UK government to do that? Or
The UK government is in dialogue with us about all of the issues about management of the budget this year. So that's an active part of discussion with the UK government. I'm very happy with the nature of those discussions so far. And obviously it has an effect on the ultimate budget management that we take forward.
And do you have a plan B if that flexibility is not granted?
I've got a solemn, absolute commitment to balance the budget this year, so we must accomplish that task.
Mm-hmm. Last question I had was around non-domestic rates. Last month I asked for details on the revaluation. We still haven't received that. Have you got any more details on the... Because obviously the poundage has been frozen,
yes. Mm-hmm.
But the intake from non-domestic rates has increased by, I think it's about 250 million. So we're trying to get an idea of what is behind that increase.
Okay. Well, I'll check on where we are with the information that the committee should have had on that. I'll check that up and get that to the committee as soon as I possibly can do.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you. John, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks very much, Convener. Don't want to go over too much old ground, although that's a temptation, obviously. A couple of things that have happened recently are I think the IMF forecast that the UK economy is not growing, unlike most other competitors, and interest rates get up to 4% last week. And I just wonder if either of these is having an impact on next year's budget.
Undoubtedly, the context that the IMF reports on will have an impact on the budget, because if the IMF are correct, then it would be quite a mighty achievement if we were not affected by those that context that the IMF cites. Obviously, interest rates rising is a particular challenge, because that affects a number of the points in relation to investment into the economy, whether that's at an individual level or whether that's at a corporate level, which obviously we need that investment in the economy to drive growth within the economy. So, for example, if interest rates rising leads to a reduction in house transaction activity, then that will have an effect on land and buildings transaction tax revenue and subsequently on the government's budget, as just one example.
Okay. Thank you. And the second area I just wanted to touch on was in dialogue with council colleagues. I mean, I think clearly they are struggling to balance their budgets, and we are struggling to balance our budgets, and everybody realises that everybody else is in a difficult place. And one or two issues they've raised with me would be around, like, revenue raising, if they could have a little bit more freedom to raise revenue. And a particular example they gave was private landlord registration fees, and another one was being allowed to increase penalty charge notices for parking and things, which, you know, looks like it would have the, you know, both improve illegal parking situation and also give a bit of extra money. I think it's been mentioned £3 million for Glasgow. Is that kind of thing? Is there any space for that kind of thing?
I'm certainly very happy to explore propositions that come forward from local government in relation to the question, which I think the convener asked me about, the work on council tax. I'm very keen that we make early progress so that if there is more flexibility that local authorities can deploy in relation to council tax, then we should try to seek that. On the two specific examples that Mr. Mason puts to me, I'm just not sure about the arrangements in relation to fixed penalty notices as to where power and control lies about that. I'd have to take that one away. But, you know, I'm very happy to consider any propositions that might assist local authorities. I do recognise the challenge that local authorities face in the current context, but as Mr. Mason correctly says, we are all facing them. I have a finite sum of money that I can allocate. I've taken decisions, not without controversy, to increase taxation. Having done that, that increases the resources I have at my disposal, and that has enabled me in the round to increase the budgets available to local authorities by over £550 million. So the if we were to increase that any further, we'd have to take those resources from someone else.
Okay, well, I mean, it's not my area of expertise, but they were certainly telling me that all local authorities had agreed there could be an increase in penalty charge notices, but it seems to have got stuck somewhere. But
I'll take that one away. I just can't quite recall what the arrangements are, but I'll give the committee a response on that.
And I mean, also on the theme of flexibility, I think you have suggested that you might be able to give local councils a bit more flexibility. And I mean, another example they gave to me was that, you know, some money goes in that is ring fenced, for example, for the health and social care partnerships. But if they are able to make a saving between them and the health board in the health and social care partnership, if a saving can be made there, that saving cannot be moved out to help some other part of the council that is under more pressure. Would that be the kind of thing that...
Well, I have to say I'm pretty sceptical about that, because if I look at that issue, that is directly related to the fact that we've got 1,700 people on delayed discharge in our hospital. So if there's somehow underspend emerging out of more efficiency in health and social care partnerships, then I would like to see that used for its purpose of making sure that people are properly supported in a care environment appropriate to them, which suggests to me that it's unlikely that resource should be taken out of health and social care partnerships and put into some other area of council activity. I think we should concentrate, because I think we've all got a collective understanding that our hospitals are operating at far too intense a level. Hospital occupancy is, well, the last time I looked at the data, in the mid-90%. It should be in the mid-80% as a maximum. So, and we've got 1,700 people on delayed discharge. So if there's resources that have been freed up because of efficiency in health and social care, I think we should use that to expand our health and social care footprint. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And another suggestion was made to me was around the question of teachers. I mean, I think the pupil-teacher ratios vary around the country in the councils. And I don't think any of us want to reduce the number of teachers. But again, it was suggested that perhaps Glasgow and some other councils all have an above-average ratio at the moment, and therefore could there be any flexibility that at least they move to the national average rather than having this extra investment?
Now, these issues have obviously been raised with us by local government and the subject of discussion with the Education Secretary, who will be making a statement to Parliament today on this subject.
Right. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Michelle. To be followed by Liz.
Good morning. Just picking up a couple of themes that have already been touched on. Firstly, in terms of public service reform, I've been through all the responses and I can see there's a lot of stuff going on, and that's absolutely clear, and I certainly await with interest for further detail on it. But I suppose one thing that jumped out at me was that it's no bad thing to ask local government to come up with their own ideas, and I'm sure they'll do that. But that bottom-up approach is only one way. What consideration have you given to a top-down approach? And it's something I raised before, the fact that we have duplicate functions across our 33 local councils. In particular, I would highlight HR and the finance kind of directorship. So presumably we've got 33 finance directors and an average salary of 88 grand or so, and so that's what, roughly 2 million each, not to mention the departments. So my question is that I consider it unlikely that local councils themselves would come up with the idea. I know we could have a centralised FD function across even some local authority areas, and likewise with HR, but is that something that you would give consideration to?
Just as a matter of fact, 32. Just so we're all on the same page. I think, well, it's an option, but there will be that. I could just imagine the sight of John Swinney turning up at COSLA headquarters to say we're going to do a top-down reform of local government and the finance. I would imagine Mr. Lumsden would be at the front of the queue to support me in all my efforts. So I think it's possible, but I think I would much rather encourage a process in which local authorities... You make the necessary changes off their hands rather than the government doing it to them. I don't think that's the way it should be done. But let me express my frustration about this point, because I think Michelle Thompson alights on a particular problem here. Let me go back to the former world I used to occupy as Education Secretary. There are 32 education authorities, 32 directors of education. And the local authorities are of wildly varying sizes. So one director of education in the city of Glasgow will be dealing with a fundamentally different proposition to the director of education in Clackmannanshire, for example. Now, some years ago, to take the Clackmannan example, Clackmannan and Stirling councils did quite a bit of collaboration and essentially got very close to running a joint education service. And nobody lost their identity. Nobody lost their kind of focus on education. But they decided to dismantle those arrangements. And I thought that was a point of regret, to be honest. So I think there is scope for exactly what Michelle Thompson suggests. I encourage local authorities to work together on the creation of regional improvement collaboratives at local authority level, amongst groups of local authorities. There's a lot of good work goes on amongst these improvement collaboratives on education. I think shared leadership would help an awful lot of these things as well. But, you know, I accept that that is me beginning to get into the territory of specifying what local government should do. And I'm left with a pretty strong impression from local government and message from local government that that's not particularly welcome.
I have every sympathy with the view expressed, Deputy First Minister. And I've probably only made myself very unpopular by suggesting that. And I'm acutely aware of local sensitivities, but it does appear to me to be the case in duplicated functions where it's not predicated on the very important people outcomes. So the FD, there's a lot of complexity to it, but they're counting and measuring broadly similar things across a range of services. And if anything, to me, it would give more light to how money is being spent. And I'll unpopular, I know, but...
Well, I think there is a substantive issue in this, because I think to be clear, it would be wrong for the government to traipse in and say this is what's going to happen. I don't think that would go very well, to be honest. But if you look at other prospects, other propositions, for example, local authorities have come together in really quite intense collaboration around some of the city deal and growth deal propositions. So at economic strategy and development levels, local authorities are working much more intensely together than they have in the past. Now, I think that throws up some significant opportunities for authorities to work closely together to rationalise, to reduce costs, and to make sure that they've got more. Nobody needs to lose their council boundaries. Government's very clear, we're not having a local government reorganisation. But collaboration between councils, if I think about Mr. Lumsden's neck of the woods, if I'm correct, Aberdeenshire Council's headquarters are within the boundaries of Aberdeen City Council. A lot of joint working might actually be, well, I know it happens, but, you know, a bit more intensively would be quite a good thing. And so I think there is scope for this, and I would simply encourage it, but I don't think it would be helpful for the man from the ministry to turn up being helpful.
Okay, understood. Yeah, just going back to an earlier point that came up in terms of the fiscal framework review, I suppose I want to dig down a wee bit into what exactly is happening here. Now, again, I fully accept the multitude of personnel changes within the UK government, and that's been clear, been quite the revolving door. But I want to understand exactly where we are. As far as I'm aware, the terms of reference is not yet agreed. So can you help us understand where exactly the blockers are, what actions you've taken, where you feel that you've been unable to make progress? Because at the moment, reading through the responses, I'm no more certain of exactly and specifically where we are with it, given its importance that we've highlighted?
Yeah. I think both the Scottish and UK governments have communicated what the topics that we're interested in pursuing. We've not been able to make headway on that, I think largely because of, and I'm not saying this to point the finger, because I think it's just an acknowledgement of reality. There's been an awful lot of change in the UK government, and there's been a lot of other issues to be wrestled with. I'm seeing the Chief Secretary to the Treasury later on this week, so I have the opportunity to pursue some of these discussions with him, and I look forward very much to that conversation, because I'm quite sure we can make some progress, and obviously I can keep the committee up to date on any developments that emerge. But I don't think there's blockers or blockages. I think it's just there's been an awful lot of other things that have had to be sorted out, and I quite understand, given what has happened in the UK in the course of the last few months, in the UK government in the last few months, I can understand that the Treasury has had some really pretty significant issues to wrestle with, and this is not absolutely mission critical.
Yeah, and so my last question then is it your perception that there's still a genuine appetite for change from the UK government, or is it hard to determine that until your meeting on Friday, and that perhaps is a question you'll ask?
I think the UK government is committed to the fiscal framework review, so I simply take that at face value, and we'll embark on those discussions in the most constructive way we can.
Yeah, and last wee question on this then, do you think it's likely, or would you hope to be in a position where there's some kind of combined statement of intent emerging from the meeting on Friday with some specifics as to progress that's been made? Is that an outcome you'd hope for?
Well, we just have to take forward, this is a routine discussion with the Welsh Finance Minister as well. So it's the fiscal, what does FISC stand for?
Financial
Interministerial Steering Committee. Too many acronyms in this world. So that's happening on Thursday, and we'll have the opportunity to discuss these issues.
Okay, thank you.
Liz?
Thank you. Mr. Swinney, just going back to the National Strategy of Economic Transformation, specifically responses to paragraphs 79 and 80, you said an interesting thing in your response that you felt that three things were absolutely critical, namely entrepreneurship, productive regional economies, and the necessary skills for building capacity. On that last point, one of the issues is about ensuring that those people who have come out of the labour force are encouraged, in some cases, to go back in. And there's been a huge amount of economic analysis done down south and in Scotland about just how difficult that process actually is, partly because of long COVID issues, but also because people feel that the changing circumstances of, I think you yourself referred to people not going back to the office. What policies do you think are best implemented to try to encourage more people who have huge range of skills that we desperately need in the economy to improve productivity, etc.? What policies do you think will best implement that? And I know it's a difficult area, but what do you think we should be doing?
I think I might perhaps best address that question by looking at two different categories of people. The first category is people who have been in economic activity, and as a consequence of whatever has happened in the course of the last couple of years, have maybe decided not to continue that economic activity. I think for a lot of these people, COVID's been very disruptive to lots of people in lots of ways, and we've got to find ways of motivating people to continue to make an economic contribution for for perhaps longer than they at this moment want to do. I think probably the key to that is entrepreneurship. I think a lot of these individuals have probably got an economic contribution they can make through entrepreneurship, and we have to make sure that our entrepreneurship activities are reaching them in a way to provide them with a route to take forward those ambitions. So that's one grouping. And the other grouping of are those who have been in economic inactivity for a lot longer. And I see this as it's part of the work that we're doing on the Child Poverty Delivery Plan. We have to erode that level of economic inactivity in Scottish society. As I've said, I think to committee before, we've seen an improvement in of about a year in a year we've seen an improvement of about one percentage point in economic inactivity. Now that might not, the committee might say, well, that's only 1%. I think that's actually pretty significant, because economic inactivity levels about 21% in Scotland. It can only ever really probably come down to something like about 15 or 16. So narrowing that by 1% is quite an achievement. So relentless focus in a supportive way, in a holistic way to those individuals is necessary, because all those cases will be complex. None of them will be simple. They'll all be complex. They'll need complex interventions to help somebody get into economic activity. But we have to do that because, as Liz Smith will know from all of her dialogue with across the economy, everyone is short of people.
That's an interesting answer. Is there an aspect to this is about trying to help employers to understand that they have a big role to play in making their workplaces more attractive, both from a working practice angle, but also from a financial aspect? To what extent, I mean, a huge number of entrepreneurs obviously in the private sector, and therefore the government has to be careful about intervening too much, but what do you think the Scottish Government can do to encourage employers to think very carefully about just how attractive their workplace is in relation to, you know, people staying at home? Is that a really big part of it? Because that's some of the evidence that we've taken from.
I think Liz Smith rightly cautions me about treading too far into private sector management practices, but I do think there are opportunities for there to be for employees to be continued to be involved in activity, but by working in a different fashion. You know, so if we go back 3 years, you know, working from home was the exception, not the rule. Hardly anyone did it. Hardly anyone used Teams and all the rest of it. Mm. The world has changed. People are able to actually undertake their, you know, their lives in a slightly less a congested fashion. So I would encourage employers to be as flexible as they can with their workforce, because I'd be surprised if they cannot get all of the benefits from their workforce that they would expect to receive.
And what about financial incentives? I saw an interesting article about the possibility of allowing over 55s who might be more encouraged to stay in the workplace if they had some tax relief on the extra savings that they've made during that older period of work. Do you think there could be some financial incentives
I'm sure these things all help in making the judgments. Where we could exercise those, I'm not certain, because I don't think we've got the flexibility to do what Liz Smith suggests. But you know, I think employers have got to look with care at how, and the government's got to look with care at what it can do to try to maximise the continued economic contribution of individuals.
Mm-hmm. And I'm sure the answer is yes, but I assume that the government's looking at ways to, you know, in terms of transport policy, housing policy, that these are all part of the issue of making it more attractive for people.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah.
Good. Just on the question about the fiscal framework, I'm sure we'll come to political debate at a much later time, but there are issues that have been put to us as a committee, and I think we're pretty much agreed on this, that there are difficulties because of the timescales of the OBR forecasts and the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecast, namely there's a bit of a gap between them. And obviously the Scottish Government has to be at the behest of both the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, whereas the Treasury requires the OBR to make its policy statement. Do you feel that complication is something that can be crossed, that we can get over this problem? And is that something that you'd like to see resolved as we move from the 2016 fiscal framework to 2024 or whenever it happens?
I think as the person who negotiated the fiscal framework,
indeed,
I recognise its necessity. There has to be a fiscal framework. But I think what I'd also accept is that it has to be practical in the way that it operates. So, one of the issues that I think the last, 10 months has demonstrated to us is the fiscal framework doesn't work where you've got an inflationary shock of the type that we are currently facing, because it has required me to do some really demanding things which have not gone, not gone down well. I've had to cut employability budgets. I'm pretty clear the Social Security Committee of this Parliament doesn't particularly think highly of that decision, but I had very few options to try to get the budget into balance. So I think if we enter the discussions from the perspective of trying to ensure that the framework operates effectively, that will be and practically, that will be a helpful way to proceed.
To see it properly inflation related in terms of...
Well, there's a variety of questions that come. One of the points the convener made was about long-term certainty and being able to offer that to the wider marketplace. I think that's really quite critical. But it's not just critical for the wider marketplace, critical for the third sector, critical for local authorities. But if we're, we're in a kind of stop-start situation, which is often where we are in budgetary terms, I understand that's not desirable. So I think there's quite a lot we could do to address the practicality of the framework.
And just lastly, when we had the academic panel in, which was discussing a lot of this problem about forecasting, that they're quite willing to accept that there is a difficulty about forecasting when one government is looking at two sets of figures and the other government's looking at one set of figures. Do you feel that is something that we can do something about for the next fiscal framework, or is it just a fact of life that that situation exists?
I think I think we can certainly try to address that issue. We follow, and we're obliged by statute to follow the Scottish Fiscal Commission advice, which of course reflects on the OBR advice.
Yeah.
So I think in statutory terms, I think the position, I don't feel, certainly in approaching the budget this year, I wasn't thinking very much that I had to reconcile the Scottish Fiscal Commission with the Office for Budget Responsibility. I was just essentially saying I have an obligation to listen to what the Scottish Fiscal Commission are saying and to take my budget decisions on the basis of that premise. So I don't think there's decision about where the centrality of advice comes from. I don't think I felt any confusion about that.
Okay, there's going to be more a question about timing.
But I'm very happy to explore any issues about that.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thanks very much. I was quite intrigued actually in the response about the comments regarding the Dundee Pathfinder project with regard to employability, and I think that's something we want to obviously look at further. Interestingly, you'll be aware that the UK government's talking about raising the pension age from 67 to 68, bringing that forward from 2044 to 2034. So that, of course, will increase the workforce. Whether I don't know how many people aged 67 to 68 will still want to remain in the workforce, but that's when the state pension age will change. But in terms of employability, yesterday I was at ACS in Motherwell. I don't know how familiar you are with that facility. It's a circular economy facility. It's the largest clothing recycling facility in Europe. Employs 150 people, and it takes kind of clothes and puts them back into the marketplace. And 16% of its workforce have disabilities. It's also got a very high proportion of refugees and ex-offenders working there. And they take a lot of people from the margins and pay well. It's very high tech, et cetera, et cetera. It's got a very low carbon footprint, et cetera. So there are a lot of really good things actually happening, and I think it's just about trying to learn from some of that best practice and see how else it can be expanded within Scotland. But I've just got one.
Can I come in on, yep, on that point, Kavira? Because I think you're light on a really important question, which is about the nature. I'm not familiar with the status and the nature of ACS, but I had the privilege on at the Business in the Parliament conference of talking to the chief executive of Dovetail Enterprises in Dundee, which is a furniture and mattress manufacturing facility, and they are I think it would be fair to say a social enterprise, I think, and they would be the best description, and they are reaching out to create economic opportunities for people who are often very remote from the labour market. And one of the projects they were talking about was the fact that they'd been successful in landing the contract for furnishing and equipping the Social Security Scotland offices in the city of Dundee. And having just been in those offices a few weeks ago, I can attest to the quality of the product that they have. But it was a perfect example of how public expenditure through public procurement, all done properly, can result in really beneficial social and economic outcomes, because there are people in the labour market, active and engaged labour today, who would not have been there had it not been for the degree of support they had had through employment at Dovetail Enterprises. And it'll be exactly the same as the example that you cite, Convener. So, and it goes back to one of the points that Liz Smith made to me, or one of the points that she put to me in a slightly different context. It takes employers to think about how they might be able to engage and activate people who are not currently active in the labour market, and to be open to that. Not everybody will be prepared to work with ex-offenders, but there will be people who, well, we need to help people to get their lives back on the road again.
As a social enterprise, I know the cross-party group in circular economy is going to visit it, and they said, I asked about ex-offenders, they said their level of productivity is excellent, actually, and if all the workforce was ex-offenders, they wouldn't mind at all, because they are able to deliver the product that's required. Just one last question then, before you, Deputy First Minister, before we have a break, before we move on to the next part of our agenda, and that's regard to private finance initiative, public-private partnerships. Now, when the Scottish Government came in 2007, there was a very significant financial burden that had been placed on it on an annualised basis, and I understand that with interest rates going up, that's a significant impact. So it's just to see what impact that's having on the Scottish Government and local authorities in terms of increased repayments.
There will, in certain projects, be implications as a consequence of interest rates. Interest rate changes. I don't have a detailed picture in front of me today, Convener. The Government does publish the information on PFI projects on an annual basis. But if there's more information I can produce for the committee, I'll look to do that.
Yes, I mean, my own local authority, it was before inflation, that was about 16, 17 million it was having to pay for four schools completed in 2007, and these payments got up to 2037, but understand there's a significant increase because a lot of these are tied into current interest rates as opposed to having a fixed rate over a period of time. So it was to look at the implications of that across the public sector. So any information on that would be helpful.
Well, happy to do that.
Okay, with that, if there's no other questions, I'll call this session to a close. We'll have a 5-minute comfort break. Thanks. bill. We have no amendments, but in terms of the standing orders, we are obliged to consider each section and schedule of the bill and the long title and agree to each formally. We will take the sections in order, with schedules being taken immediately after the section that introduces them and the long title last. Fortunately, standing orders allows us to put a single question where groups of sections or schedules are to be considered consecutively, and unless members disagree, that is what I propose to do. So, firstly, the question is that Section 1, Schedule 1, Section 2, Schedule 2, Section 3, Schedule 3, and Sections 4 to 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
In our minded? We are all agreed. John continuing his Richard Lyle impersonation, even at the committee. Secondly, the question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed? And that ends stage two consideration of the bill. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'll now suspend the meeting for 1 minute before we move on to our second agenda item, which will consider the budget bill at stage two.